Justice. A disagreement between a prosecutor and a state attorney general leaves a man languishing in prison.
If truth matters, if justice is what really is important, why can't we just get to that?
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
CFO, Caregiver, Eclipse Chaser, a Raymond James Financial Advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
600,000. That is the estimated number of Americans who have now died from COVID. The latest data from Johns Hopkins University come at a bittersweet moment. Two states once hit hard by the pandemic, California and New York, ended nearly all health restrictions on businesses and gatherings today. More than 65% of all individuals over the age of 18 have gotten at least one dose of the vaccine. But those percentages are significantly lower in some places. Well under half of adults in Mississippi, Alabama, Louisiana, Georgia, and Wyoming have had at least one shot. We look at the latest, even as concerns grow about some of the variants. Dr. Robert Wachter is the chair of the Department of Medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, and he joins us now. Dr. Wachter, thank you very much for being with us. As we mourn our losses, and they are significant, we are, as we just pointed out, seeing some moments of progress, are we not?
Oh, we are. It's you got it right. It's a bittersweet day. 600,000 people have passed away in the United States. That's more people than live in the city of Baltimore or the city of Milwaukee. So it's staggering. And it's also staggering to think that many could have been saved if we had responded better. But the vaccination is going generally quite well. And the case rates, the hospitalization rates, and the death rates have come down massively. So we find ourselves in a good place. And it is appropriate for us to be opening up and getting back toward normal, although there are a few clouds still on the horizon.
And as we talk about the progress we've made, it is important, as we said at the outset, to mark the losses. 600,000 is more by far than any other country in the world.
Yes. And, the numbers are so big that it's hard to get your mind around them. And you really have to do some work to say each one is a human being who had a family and friends and a life. And it's really something we have to take some time, take a step back and really think hard about what happened. Some of it was inevitable given this pandemic. Some of it, I think, didn't have to happen. As we take stock, we should also take stock on our response and think about how we might do better the next time.
And as we're thinking about what was done right and what wasn't, Dr. Wachter, we know the CDC today is raising warnings about one of the new variants out there, the so-called Delta variant. What do we know about it? How widespread is it right now in this country?
Yeah, it is somewhat concerning. So the, you know, we've seen lots of different variants through 2020. I spent a lot of my time telling people there are tons of variants. They're not doing anything important. But that changed with the Alpha variant, the one that that was first reported from the UK. And now it's changed again with the Delta variant, the one that was first reported in India. There are three things about variants to pay attention to. One is, are they more infectious? The second is, are they more serious? If you get it, are you more likely to get very sick and go to the hospital and die? The third is, are they resistant to vaccines or to immunity? And the Delta variant appears to be more infectious than the Alpha variant, which was more infectious than the original. So it's substantially better at its job at infecting people. It appears to be more serious. The data on that is a little bit less clear, but I think that the consensus is it probably is more serious. And it has some ability to evade the vaccine. The great news is when you're fully vaccinated, the vaccines work spectacularly well, as they do against the original. But you can tell that it has some superpowers because the first dose of your vaccine, which was 80% effective for Pfizer and Moderna with the original virus, now appears to be only 30 or 35% effective. So you need to be fully vaccinated in order to stave off this variant. It's now responsible for somewhere between 6 and 10% of the infections in the United States. And if we're anything like the UK, and there's no reason to believe we won't be, within a month or two, it will become the dominant virus. So if you're not vaccinated, you're not any better at fighting off a virus than you were a year ago, but the virus has gotten substantially better at its job than it was a year ago. So it's yet another reason that people really need to get vaccinated when they have the chance.
The warning signal, the flashing red light couldn't be any clearer, it sounds like. If you don't have a vaccination, then you should worry about this.
I think that's right, and we are beginning to see this pattern play out in hospitals and in states where there are younger people coming in the hospital, and in many cases, they are unvaccinated. And of course, they thought they were fine, but they are not. And that's without very much of this Delta variant around. So when this Delta variant does hit us, we're going to see more people who are unvaccinated get infected. They are probably going to have worse outcomes. And one of the real differences, this first versus second dose thing may not seem like a big deal. But if you think about it, if we were dealing with the original virus, all right, I hear it's coming. I hear there are more cases in my state or my community. I'm going to get vaccinated now. I've been waiting. And a couple of weeks after that first shot, you were moderately well protected. You didn't reach full protection until after the second shot. With this variant, at least so far, it looks like you're not going to be fully protected for about 5 or 6 weeks until you're fully vaccinated. That first shot doesn't do the same job that it used to do. So waiting until you hear that there's an uptake in cases is now a very bad strategy that's likely to not go well.
And Dr. Wachter, is it accurate to say that most of the people who are now hospitalized with COVID are individuals who had not had their full vaccinations yet?
We don't have great data on that. That's what we're hearing anecdotally, and that's certainly what we're seeing. We're not seeing that many hospitalizations here in California, certainly not in San Francisco, because virtually everybody's vaccinated. We've done very, very well. But when I talk to colleagues around the country and they say, you know, who am I seeing in the hospital, in the intensive care unit, it increasingly is folks that did not get vaccinated or have only gotten their first shot. So that is a warning sign that if you're not vaccinated, you may be lulled because you see the case rates going down and you say, look, I don't have to worry about anything. But in fact, you do. The case rates are going down because the vaccinated people are not getting infected. You are no better protected than you were in January 2020. And actually, you're less protected because the virus is better at its job than it was in January 2020. So, you know, those of us who take care of patients, we plead for people to get vaccinated. Please stop waiting. This is the time, particularly if the Delta variant is going to hit us. It will hit us in the fall, and it may hit us pretty hard.
The message is clear, and it's a sobering message. Dr. Robert Wachter with the University of California, San Francisco, thank you.
Thank you.
President Biden has arrived in Geneva tonight, making ready for his meeting with Russia's President Vladimir Putin tomorrow. But first, he moved today to end a tariff war with the European Union. White House correspondent Yamiche Alcindor reports.
President Biden's final day in Belgium, a diplomatic sprint. Photo ops at the palace with the Belgian king.
America's back, and which is why we're here in full force.
Then meetings at the European Commission headquarters.
It's overwhelming the interest of the United States of America to have a great relationship with NATO and with the EU.
One early product of Mr. Biden's EU engagement, a major trade resolution. This morning, the U.S. and EU announced they reached an agreement to end a 17-year-long trade dispute. It involves aircraft subsidies for the American company Boeing and the European multinational Airbus. Former President Trump escalated the U.S.-EU trade war. He slapped tariffs on European metals and other goods. Today, U.S. and EU officials vowed to end the larger trade dispute. In Brussels today, U.S. Trade Representative Katherine Tai told reporters that the deal will impact 700,000 jobs in the U.S. It comes as China is on track to become a major rival in airplane manufacturing. After his meetings in Brussels, President Biden flew to Geneva, Switzerland. Tomorrow, he'll meet with Russian President Vladimir Putin.
He's tough, and I have found that he is a, as they say, when he used to play ball, a worthy adversary.
U.S. officials say the president's meetings with Putin and Russian officials are expected to start around 1 p.m. local time. They could last 4 to 5 hours or even longer. Following the meetings, Mr. Biden is scheduled to hold a press conference without Putin, who will speak separately. The two leaders have met before, in 2011, when Mr. Biden was vice president. Yesterday in Brussels, President Biden said he plans to take a tough line with Putin. But he also will try to sort out any common challenges they can address together.
We should decide where it's in our mutual interest and the interest of the world to cooperate and see if we can do that. And the areas where we don't agree, make it clear what the red lines are.
Administration officials say Mr. Biden plans to raise a number of issues, among them ransomware attacks against U.S. infrastructure by criminals in Russia, as well as Ukraine, human rights, and arms control. Sources close to Mr. Biden tell the NewsHour the main goal of the meeting is for the president to show U.S. strength and to create a stark contrast to former President Trump. In 2018, after meeting with Putin in Helsinki, Finland, Trump told reporters that he believed Putin over U.S. intelligence officials, that Russia did not meddle in the 2016 presidential election. Today in Geneva, President Biden was questioned about whether he was ready to meet Putin. He had a simple answer, quote, "I'm always ready."
And Yamiche joins me now. Hello, Yamiche. So as you reported, President Biden did meet with European Union leaders today. They announced a trade deal. Tell us about the significance of that.
Well, this trade deal between President Biden and the European Union is seen as a significant step toward calming the trade disputes that really go past the Trump era. President Trump, former President Trump, was really seen as hostile to European leaders and countries. He upped tariffs. And this is really President Biden wanting to signal that the United States and our European allies are on the same page. This is a 5-year truce, and it's between Europe's Airbus and the United States Boeing. I should also note that White House officials have been underscoring over and over again that they're looking for foreign policy for the middle class, to benefit the middle class. And this gets to that, they say, because this is going to impact about 700,000 jobs.
And meanwhile, Yamiche, we know the president has flown on to Geneva a day ahead of his meeting with the Russian president, Vladimir Putin. What do we know about the issues President Biden plans to raise with Mr. Putin?
Well, this is now, of course, the high-stakes meeting that we've been waiting for now several weeks. President Biden and Russian President Vladimir Putin are going to be meeting at a villa just behind me. And the stakes are really, really high for this. There are all eyes looking at these two leaders. There's a lot on the agenda, including talking about ransomware attacks that have reportedly been carried out by criminals living in Russia. There's also the idea of Russia meddling in elections and disinformation. There's Ukraine and the annexing of Crimea. And there's really human rights issues. So President Biden says he has a long list. He wants to have a firm hand with Russia. And he also wants to make a stark contrast between his predecessor, former President Donald Trump, who was seen as cozying up to Russia.
And what is it how is it that this meeting is expected to shape their relationship going forward? What are American officials telling you they want from this meeting?
Well, that is a key question, Judy. What exactly is President Biden looking for in this meeting with the Russian president? And how really will it benefit the American people? That's a question that I've been putting to White House sources and aides. And they say this is really about showing that the U.S. is strong and that the U.S. can confront Russia head on. There's also this sense that President Biden really wants to turn the page and not be like his predecessor. There is a feeling here that this meeting is going to be going on for some 4 to 5 hours. So there's going to be a lot to talk about. Now, President Biden, though, has called the Russian president a killer. He has said that he does not trust him. So there really is this feeling that while President Biden is here meeting with him, that he really wants to try to find some common ground, but also wants to make the case that the United States should be talking to, in some ways, our adversaries, as well as the people that are close to us, our allies. And President Biden will be holding that solo press conference. And White House officials tell me it's because he does not want to be seen as competing with the president of Russia. He doesn't want to be seen as looking at who spoke longest. And he really wants to be making the case why this is important for the American people. But there are a lot of questions about what are the deliverables that are going to come out of this meeting. And we're going to, of course, be hopefully asking some questions in that press conference and getting some answers, Judy.
Well, the two men do have a bit of a history together, so we will be really interested to see how that meeting goes. Yamiche Alcindor with President Biden in Geneva, Switzerland. Thank you, Yamiche.
Thanks so much.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz at NewsHour West. In for Stephanie Tsai, we'll return to Judy Woodruff and the full program after the latest headlines. Newly released emails shed more light on how President Trump and his allies pressed the U.S. Justice Department to challenge the 2020 election results. The U.S. House of Representatives Oversight Committee obtained the emails. They show Trump, White House officials, and others pushing claims of voter fraud. Justice Department leaders dismiss the claims as false. New bursts of gun violence have claimed more lives across the country. In Chicago, police today were hunting at least for one shooter. They said four people were killed and four others wounded when an argument broke out in a house on the South Side and gunfire erupted.
In every case, and this is case after case after case, where we have conflict and you put a gun in someone's hand, you increase, particularly an illegal gun, you increase the opportunity for violent crime.
Earlier in Albertville, Alabama, police said a worker at a fire hydrant plant fatally shot two people and wounded two more before killing himself later. Tensions flared in East Jerusalem today over a march by Israeli ultra-nationalists. Hundreds of people paraded with Israeli flags as some of them chanted, quote, death to Arabs. Israel's new government called the slogans a disgrace. Palestinians responded with protests. Some in Gaza launched incendiary balloons that sparked fires in southern Israel. And there are reports tonight that in response, Israeli planes have conducted airstrikes against Hamas in Gaza. Well, back in this country, former Congressman Dana Rohrabacher has confirmed he joined pro-Trump protests outside the U.S. Capitol on January 6. A Maine newspaper reports the California Republican entered a restricted zone, but there is no indication that he stormed the building. Rohrabacher served in Congress for 30 years before his defeat in 2018. The Biden White House has put out word that it is giving Senate infrastructure negotiations another week to 10 days. Otherwise, Democrats might try to pass the president's sweeping plan on their own in the 50-50 Senate. Party leaders divided today over a bipartisan plan of nearly $1 trillion.
I think there are many people, maybe everybody in our caucus, who believes it's a good start, but it doesn't do enough. It won't be enough on climate. It won't be enough on revenues. It won't be enough on some of the human infrastructure, like paid leave and child care.
I would love to see us get an outcome on infrastructure. It's important. The country needs it. We have a history of doing infrastructure on a bipartisan basis.
The U.S. Senate today also unanimously passed a bill to establish Juneteenth as a federal holiday. The day, which officially falls on June 19th, commemorates the end of slavery in the U.S. in 1865. The bill now goes to the House of Representatives. Some 15,000 Southern Baptists convened today in Nashville for a critical meeting. Now, the nation's largest Protestant denomination is wrestling with race, sexual abuse by church officials, and a conservative push for greater control. Late today, Alabama pastor Ed Linton, who has worked to bridge racial divides, was elected the church's new president. He defeated conservative Mike Stone in the second round of voting. Still to come on the News Hour, the issues at stake when President Biden faces off with Vladimir Putin. Questions of authority leaves one man's quest for freedom in limbo. Plus, the pandemic makes college costs unsustainable for students and institutions.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The White House published its framework today for how it intends to combat one of the most pressing national security threats, domestic terrorism. It comes nearly 6 months after pro-Trump rioters overwhelmed the U.S. Capitol on January 6th. Amna Nawaz reports.
That's right, Judy. It was President Biden's Attorney General Merrick Garland who spoke before cameras today to roll out this 32-page strategy. Here's what he said.
During President Biden's first week in office, he directed the administration to undertake an assessment of the domestic terrorism threat and then to use that assessment to develop the national strategy being released today. In March, they concluded that domestic violent extremists posed an elevated threat to the homeland in 2021. In the FBI's view, the top domestic violent extremist threat comes from racially or ethnically motivated violent extremists, specifically those who advocated for the superiority of the white race.
Now, the strategy outlines a whole-of-government approach to the problem. It calls for better information sharing among the many agencies that are involved, calls for a broader push to short-circuit the ability of domestic extremist groups to recruit new members online, and improved screening to root out extremism within the U.S. military and law enforcement. Mary McCord previously served as the top national security official in the Justice Department. She studies and writes about these issues at Georgetown University, and she joins me now. Mary McCord, welcome back to the News Hour. When you look at this strategy, what does it say, the size and the scope of it? What does it say to you about how this administration views domestic terrorism in 2021?
Well, I think it serves an important signaling function. First, that this administration recognizes the threat from domestic extremist violence and domestic terrorism. And that is something that has not really been seriously recognized in the previous administration. Secondly, it acknowledges that this administration is going to put that threat at the highest level and respond to it and put it in a equivalency to other terrorist threats, international terrorist threats. And that means not just a whole of government approach, but a whole of society approach. So I think those signaling functions before we even get to the meat of the strategy are very important.
We should mention the federal officials have noted the threat of domestic violent extremism before. We know in 2017, the FBI reported white supremacists posed a lethal threat. There was in 2019 a framework presented by then acting Secretary of Homeland Security Kevin McAleenan to counter violent white supremacy. When you look at the Biden strategy, what are the effective parts? What's going to make the difference this time?
Well, a strategy is just that, right? It's words on paper that, you know, establish, in this case, pillars of activity that's going to be taking place. But you're right to suggest that, you know, what's going to come from it? What does that mean is going to happen on the ground? And I think, you know, that in some ways remains to be seen, but there's already much that has happened even before the strategy was published, right? We've seen the Department of Defense and the Department of Homeland Security announce measures to try to eliminate extremism within their ranks. We've seen more money requested for resources for combating violent extremism. So there's been already steps taken, and I think that's what we are going to see more of. There's a lot of plans in this document for things, and I think things that are so important, like providing more information international to federal to state to local and the reverse, so that there's a better coordination, there's a better understanding of the threat, and a better ability to actually counter it. I think that, you know, you're going to see actions taking place to try to reduce the impact of disinformation and other extremist rhetoric that fuels extremist violence online. You'll see efforts to undertake that. And I think we'll see, just as we're already seeing post January 6th, a real emphasis from our law enforcement agencies to combat this threat. And that is an area where they need to really be able to reach out to the communities, build trust from communities who sometimes don't trust law enforcement to be able to really be effective in this area.
Well, you know, Mary, some of that broad information sharing has raised concerns among some groups. So let me ask you about what is not in the strategy. The ACLU's National Security Project Director, Hina Shumsi, put out a response to the strategy saying, quote, the strategy includes none of the civil rights and liberty safeguards that rights group and communities of color have long sought. We know in the past, Mary, counterterrorism measures have resulted in abuse of power and over-surveillance of communities of color, Muslims in particular. Is there room in this strategy, you think, for civil rights abuses down the line?
So I think, again, the strategy is really not at the level of detail where I think we'd be seeing exactly where the vulnerabilities to abuse are and what kinds of measures need to be taken to prevent that. So I very much appreciate Hina Shamsi's comments. I do think AG Garland, as well in his speech today, as well as the document itself, makes clear that everything that's being proposed is being proposed to be done within, with respect to civil rights and civil liberties and constitutional values. So I think the devil will be in the details. And I think Hina Shamsi will be raising good points as we move forward and we see actual actions, policies, and, you know, potentially legislation, although not necessarily, and other actions that the Department of Justice, Department of Homeland Security, Department of Defense, et cetera, that they take to implement that. That's where we really will need to be looking to see that civil rights and civil liberties are protected.
You know, Mary, all of those agencies for two decades have been focused almost exclusively on an entirely different threat, right? Mostly a foreign threat. We're talking about violent Islamist extremism. Culturally, can you get all of those systems of power to pivot? Especially when you look at, as we reported earlier, you know, we know what happened on January 6th. There were military veterans. There were law enforcement officials. There was a former member of Congress in the crowd outside the Capitol that day.
So I think that it's right that the overwhelming resources have been put toward the international terrorist threat since 9/11. But it's not as though this threat was ignored. I mean, as you noted already, Director Wray, you know, has been saying now for a couple of years, has been emphasizing the significance in terms of lethality of the domestic terrorist threat. We've seen cases brought by the FBI and the Department of Justice, not only post January 6th, but over the last few years, numerous cases brought to disrupt threats, because obviously they'd prefer to disrupt a threat before a terrorist attack happens. But you're right that, you know, this is a much more of a mandate for change here. And I do think that the federal government, you know, has enough power and authority and Congress through oversight to ensure that directives are being implemented and that there really is a change in resources. I think getting the states and locals also on board might be even a bigger challenge, and that will need to be incentivized through potentially through some of the grants that are given from the federal government to states and locals and have some strings attached to those grants that include this type of prioritization. So I think it's going to take all of those efforts. And, you know, starting, frankly, with, you know, renewed emphasis put on vetting and screening of government employees who are in positions that sensitive positions or positions of dealing with the terrorist threat, and, you know, looking at current employees, and I'm really talking about here about our military and our law enforcement, and making sure that we don't have extremists in the ranks, because even though they have First Amendment rights, they don't have a First Amendment right to be law enforcement. And extremist views, racist views, those things are incompatible with the role of law enforcement and the military. And there is leeway within our constitutional framework, courts have told us, for government employers to take action to eradicate those types of extremist viewpoints, violent, anti-government, racist viewpoints from law enforcement and the military.
That is Mary McCord, formerly of the Justice Department, now at Georgetown University. Mary, thanks for being with us. Always good to see you.
The highest profile event of President Biden's first trip abroad is set to take place just hours from now, his summit with Russia's President Vladimir Putin. Nick Schifrin previews the meeting between the U.S. president and the man who has led Russia for more than 20 years.
For critics of the Kremlin, Russia's never been a welcoming place. But this year, the state's increased repression and tried to silence all resistance. Last week, it labeled the organization led by opposition leader Alexei Navalny an extremist group, the equivalent of ISIS. Navalny helped inspire millions to call for Vladimir Putin to leave office. But 3 months before parliamentary elections, protests like these are now banned, and the Kremlin is trying to suppress anyone, anywhere who dares dissent.
The crackdown on the, not only on the opposition leaders, on the independent journalists, independent bloggers, it seems like it's the massive repression.
Dmitry Gudkov is a former member of parliament and opposition politician. He's nowhere near as popular as Navalny, but he posts videos highlighting government corruption and criticizes Putin for rewriting the constitution to stay in power until 2036.
Really, it's an ideal career. Become the president, rewrite the laws to suit yourself, retire, become the head of the mafia, and do whatever you want.
But earlier this month, Gudkov said goodbye to his wife and fled Russia after he was arrested and authorities threatened his family. He drove to Ukraine in the car where we conducted our interview.
The Kremlin is really afraid of people taken to the street. That's why they decided to get rid of all opposition leaders who could lead the protest at that time.
President Biden promises to challenge Putin on his crackdown on critics.
Is there anything that the U.S. can do, do you think, to change Putin's behavior?
I don't think that it's possible to influence on Putin. I don't think Putin wants something from the United States. Just let me do what I want. The United States, get away from here. No, that's what he wants.
If President Biden were to raise issues about Russian domestic politics, I think President Putin would raise issues regarding American domestic politics. So that's where the discussion will probably stop.
Dmitry Trenin directs the Carnegie Moscow Center think tank. He says for President Putin, domestic politics are a red line. Another Putin red line, Ukraine. Last week, Putin issued a new warning on state TV that Ukraine's joining NATO was unacceptable because it could host U.S. missiles.
If Ukraine becomes a NATO member, the flight to Moscow goes down to 7 to 10 minutes. In order to shorten the time for us to 7 to 10 minutes, we'd have to put rockets on the Canadian or Mexican border.
The topic of real, not hypothetical, missiles is actually what both Putin and Biden want to discuss. The only existing nuclear arms control treaty, New START, now expires in 5 years, after Presidents Biden and Putin extended it earlier this year.
A decision by the two presidents to give a nod to the beginning of a dialogue on strategic stability issues is something that I would expect as the principal result of this Geneva meeting.
But it won't be easy because the two sides have different priorities. The U.S. wants to limit Russia's new nuclear-propelled weapons, including one that blew up Florida in a Kremlin video. The U.S. also wants to limit Russia's smaller tactical nuclear weapons. Russia wants to limit U.S. non-nuclear weapons and the U.S.'s missile defense systems in Eastern Europe.
Reaching a new agreement between the United States and Russia on strategic arms would be immensely more difficult now than concluding the New START treaty. There's also the cyber factor that has to be taken into account.
For the U.S., that cyber factor is perhaps the most pressing. In April, many Americans struggled to get gas after a ransomware attack crippled the country's largest gas pipeline. Cyber criminals have targeted one of the world's largest meat processing companies, American hospitals, schools, police departments, a challenge that the FBI compares to 9/11.
This can't keep going on, and the vast majority of the criminals are operating out of Russia, and we need to demand that Vladimir Putin fix that problem and put these people in jail.
Dmitry Alperovich is the chairman of the Silverado Policy Accelerator and grew up in Russia. He was the first to identify Russian hackers who targeted the 2016 election. He says those hackers are state-sponsored and Russia will never give them up. But he says Russia could be willing to crack down on cyber criminals,
Putin does not care about them. He's letting them operate within Russia because right now they suit his purpose of continuously harassing the West. But if he sees them as a liability, he will not hesitate to throw them into a penal colony in order to further his interests.
Alperovitch urges Biden to threaten sanctions against the core of the Russian economy, oil, gas, and its sovereign debt sales.
Putin believes in Russia's greatness. He is not going to bend to overt American pressure. But if you can tell him that, Vladimir, unless you arrest these 15 people who are not part of the regime, those sanctions will go into place a couple months from now.
Trennan warns that threat would be dangerous.
If that's the logic of the future of the relationship, then we're going down to a showdown and possibly a collision, a real one.
President Biden has long viewed Putin skeptically and often tells the same story about their 2011 meeting.
I said, look through your eyes, and I don't think you have a soul.
So you know Vladimir Putin. You think he's a killer?
Mm-hmm. I do.
On Sunday, President Biden doubted anything the U.S. offered would change Putin.
But why do you think he hasn't changed his behavior in spite of everything the U.S. has done to this point?
He's Vladimir Putin.
And so senior U.S. officials say tomorrow is less about breakthroughs than avoiding further breakups in a relationship both sides agree is worse than it's been in decades. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
Across the country, a number of prosecutors are working to overturn wrongful convictions, helping to free the very people their offices convicted in the past, aiming to right historical injustices. But as John Yang reports, a battle in Missouri between a progressive prosecutor and a conservative state attorney general has left one man's quest for freedom in limbo.
I'm Mr. Johnson.
For nearly 26 years, Lamar Johnson's been serving life without the possibility of parole for a murder he says he didn't commit.
For the most part, prison is just constant fear, especially when you first come in, it's afraid of how it is and what's going to happen to you. Then it's just fear of, you know, dying in prison, fear of getting sick in prison, fear of being abandoned. In my case, fear of just not having the opportunity to be heard.
Now 47 years old, Johnson was only 21 when he was locked up. For decades, he fought his conviction without the help of a lawyer.
I've not even had a hearing on any of the evidence that I have presented, and I don't understand why.
The truth of the matter is that it's very easy to get a wrongful conviction. It's incredibly difficult to overturn one.
Today, Lindsay Runnels and the Midwest Innocence Project represent Johnson. Ronald spoke to us at the scene of the crime in question, the October 30th, 1994 murder of Marcus Boyd, a friend of Johnson's. According to court papers, Boyd was selling crack cocaine to a friend.
So Lindsay, set the scene for us. It was at night, from what I can tell, about 9 o'clock at night.
That's right, not much light. There's this overhead street light here. But it was dark, 9 o'clock in the fall. They're sitting on the porch and two fully masked black males dressed in all black clothing came around from behind the house, through the alleys here, ran up onto the porch and grabbed Marcus.
There was a struggle and Marcus Boyd was fatally shot.
And where was Lamar?
He was about 3.5 miles from here.
And how do we know he was there?
He was there with his girlfriend who testified at trial and two other people.
At Johnson's trial, his girlfriend said he left the house for less than 5 minutes to meet a friend, which turned out to be a drug deal. Police testified he could have left and killed Boyd in no more than 5 minutes. But look at a Google map showing the route between the two locations. It takes about double that to go just one way. And police said the other man on the porch identified Johnson, despite the fact that he said it was dark and that both attackers hid their faces.
They wore ski masks that had a cutout for the eye area and portions of the nose.
So that's all that was visible?
That's correct.
Just the eyes and a little bit of the nose?
Right.
What's more, since Johnson's conviction, two men have confessed to being the ones who killed Boyd and said Johnson had nothing to do with it.
It shows that sometimes there is a miscarriage of justice.
In 2018, Johnson found an unexpected ally in St. Louis Circuit Attorney Kimberly Gardner, the current head of the very office that put him away.
I believe that because I'm a minister of justice and because I uncovered wrongdoing in this case, it is my obligation under the Constitution, not just the state, but the U.S. Constitution, to correct a wrongful conviction. And that's what I did.
His case is extremely old.
Gardner began to re-examine Johnson's case through her newly created Conviction Integrity Unit, a tool progressive prosecutors are increasingly using to prevent, identify, and undo wrongful convictions.
A Conviction Integrity Unit, in my mind, is not only to correct wrongful convictions, it's actually to teach prosecutors, police, to be a training tool to actually help us do a better job. We have to train our attorneys that in the end of the day, we're ministers of justice, to pursue justice, not merely convictions.
According to a national database, last year there were 74 conviction integrity units operating in the United States, 8 of them newly opened. Together, they were responsible for nearly half of the country's 129 exonerations. Gardner's investigation turned up even more proof of Johnson's innocence. The prosecution eyewitness recanted, admitting he'd only identified Johnson because police told him Johnson was guilty. And her team found records showing prosecutors paid that witness more than $4,000 for housing and expenses, information that was never disclosed to the defense.
So you have no evidence that he committed the crime. You have the confession of two other people that they committed the crime and that he did not. You've raised pretty good questions about whether or not the trial was fair. People will ask, then why is he in prison?
That's a good question. I mean, that's a good question.
In 2019, armed with her new evidence, Gardner went to court to ask for a new trial. For Johnson, having the top St. Louis prosecutor on his side was powerful.
I knew the Innocence Project believed me that three different directors, all types of law students, all type of law professors, everybody looked at the case and they all said the same thing. But she represented the state. And it was, the first time that somebody from the other side had acknowledged the same thing.
But it wasn't enough. A judge threw out Gardner's request for a new trial.
Many say this case has become less about Lamar Johnson and the evidence of his innocence, and more about a struggle between a conservative state attorney general and a progressive prosecutor.
Hands up! Don't shoot!
In the wake of the death of Michael Brown in nearby Ferguson and the protests and unrest that followed, Gardner was elected in 2016 on a pledge to shake up the St. Louis criminal justice system. She's done that, but it hasn't made her very popular with the political establishment. When Gardner asked for a new trial for Johnson, the judge took the unusual step of appointing State Attorney General Eric Schmidt, a Republican, to intervene. Schmidt argued that the law doesn't give Gardner the power to ask for a new trial, despite the fact that in 2018, another Missouri prosecutor was allowed to set aside two convictions in his district based on new evidence.
The Attorney General never questioned whether Lamar Johnson was innocent or there was any evidence that Lamar Johnson committed the crime. What he talked about was whether the prosecutor, like myself, had the ability to actually correct wrongful convictions. And that's a problem because you have a duty, and your duty is to protect everyone, even people who are incarcerated.
The judge and later the state Supreme Court agreed with Schmidt. For Johnson, who thought he had a breakthrough when he got the backing of Gardner's Conviction Integrity Unit, it was a heavy blow.
I was just sure that they was going to at least grant me a hearing. And when they said no, it was devastating.
So this is my dad, this is me, and this is my grandma May. Which
that was true for Johnson's family, too. Daughter Kiera Barrow was just an infant when he was locked up. Despite a lifetime apart, she and her father have grown close.
All the hope that you had is just quickly snatched from you. It's frustrating because the conversation is not whether or not he's innocent, but who has the power in the authority to release him.
Gardner says this was about politics.
If I was part of the status quo club of prosecutors, I believe Lamar Johnson would be home yesterday. And I am sorry for that.
Schmidt's office never responded to multiple requests from the NewsHour for comment. Since the state Supreme Court decision, one legal hurdle to a new trial for Johnson could soon be removed. Last month, the Missouri legislature passed a new bill explicitly allowing local prosecutors to ask for the convictions of those wrongly imprisoned to be set aside. It's on Governor Mike Parson's desk awaiting his decision. Attorney General Schmidt, now running for the U.S. Senate, could still object and a judge would still have the final say. Meanwhile, Johnson's attorneys have a plan of their own. Asked the courts to release him because his constitutional rights were violated at trial.
But that is a hard process. There's a lot of things that have to happen before he gets that day in court, as we say. There'll be objection if passed is any indication of the future. I assume that the Attorney General's office will object to Lamar Johnson getting a hearing.
My concern is just simply getting caught up for God knows how long over procedural matters. Procedural technicalities. I mean, if truth matters, if justice is what really is important, why can't we just get to that?
Johnson says he remains hopeful that one day he'll be free.
From the beginning, I knew something was wrong because I got convicted for something I didn't do. And so I knew the truth was out there somehow, and I just didn't give up. And knowing that kept me hopeful. Like, as long as there's life, there's hope. And so as long as there's hope, I know that so this situation can be righted.
Even when that hope is dashed again and again by a system that seems stacked against him. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang in Jefferson City, Missouri.
The COVID-19 pandemic has forced colleges to adapt like never before, and it's continuing to alter the way millions of American students are receiving instruction. Jeffrey Brown looks at the effects of those changes and what they could mean in the future. It's part of our ongoing series, Rethinking College.
Empty campuses, eerily quiet classrooms, unused dormitories. A new normal in a time of pandemic. But even before COVID hit, this was a vision some colleges were confronting.
College students and faculty have been forced into remote Zoom classes around the country this year, of course. But here at small Unity College in Central Maine, they were already moving in that direction, part of longer-term changes in higher education, not just to survive a pandemic, but to survive at all.
We as an industry were a little bit in denial, in my opinion.
Melek Peter Khoury is Unity's president.
The tier one institutions are in a league of their own. But for the rest of us, I think some noticed that something had to change. We just decided to start looking at those changes before it became a problem, which is harder. Sometimes it is easier for institutions to make change when in crisis.
Founded in 1965, Unity is a private liberal arts college known for its environmental studies focus and hands-on experience.
Unity College is America's environmental college.
But Khoury says even before the pandemic, lower enrollment and higher costs were making its traditional model unsustainable, threatening the college's future.
So I wanted to show some of the field experience.
He began to rethink how instruction could be delivered, including remotely. Then came the pandemic.
We basically lost $12 million in revenue overnight, having to send everyone home. Lucky for us, 5 years prior, we had started to invest in technology. So we were able to allow students to continue their education, just not how they started. So our distance education students were fine. Our residential students were really upset by it.
Unity is certainly not alone. While the vast majority of colleges have announced plans to return to more normal operations next fall, many are still facing dire financial forecasts going forward. Across the country, more than 60 colleges have closed or merged since 2016. That's what Khoury says he was trying to avoid when Unity announced major changes over the summer, laying off or furloughing about 30% of its staff and shifting permanently to an online and hybrid model. It didn't sit well with some students.
I was willing to be online for the fall, for the pandemic, and just keep everyone safe, but anything further than that, you know, that just wasn't what I signed up for.
20-year-old Delana Kerwin came to Unity in 2019 to study wildlife and fisheries biology. But she decided to leave last fall and transfer elsewhere.
Why was the traditional college experience important to you?
So that I could directly talk with my professors and go to their office hours, as well as like the different study groups that they had, because you can't really simulate, you know, working with animals on a computer. And so that was extremely important, that I get that hands-on experience so that I can, you know, do the best in my career one day.
And this is something that comes up when you design a survey.
But Unity's move to hybrid learning was exactly what 42-year-old Joshua Tate was looking for. A father to a 3-year-old son, Tate is a sophomore.
It has been very beneficial to me. When I started out my first term in Unity College, we only had one car and my girlfriend was using it to go to work, so I really needed something that I could do from home and also be a caretaker for my child.
Which isn't really a distinction that you can make for all of the birds, for sure.
But Tate says he also came to Unity for opportunities like this one. He and Professor Ali McKnight recently hiked several miles into nearby woods as part of an ornithology class. The goal on this night was to survey the surrounding area for American woodcocks, a small bird that often comes out after sunset.
Almost every course I've taught this year has some big component where students have to go out to an area near wherever they are and apply the techniques that we're learning about, so they're not just reading about things and watching videos.
Welcome to Environmental Justice. This course
Some
really
Unity professors like Katara Moore are also happy with the new flexibility. Moore can now live in Philadelphia and work remotely in rural Maine.
As I'm an urban geographer, I study environmental justice in cities, and so it just would be an oxymoron in a way for me to move to Maine to work. And then plus my family is here. You know, I have a 94-year-old grandmother. My husband's job is here in Philadelphia. He's been working this job for 32 years. And so it would be no way possible for me to move to Maine.
But these changes have many upset and raise a new kind of threat to the town of Unity itself.
I think that the town is reeling right now from the loss of the students, as well as the faculty who have moved on or faculty who are now working from home.
Tamika Ajemian moved to the area 2 years ago and opened Unity Kitchen. She says the restaurant had been a popular hangout for faculty and students, but today it's barely hanging on.
I don't think that I would have bought this building and started this business if there wasn't something here that I thought would help support us and help us grow, which is the school, because there really isn't anything else here.
Unity President Khoury admits the move to permanent hybrid and distance learning has been both difficult and controversial. But he says offering students many options, residential, fully online, a mix of the two, even opening a new technical school, has led to record enrollment.
We've gone from a 50-year average enrollment of about 600, and we're currently at 1,600 students. Our average age at Unity College for student population for the last 50 years has been around 19. It's now almost 30.
Earlier this month, Unity announced it will reopen its campus in the fall. But Khoury says he's uncertain as to exactly how many students will return. About two-thirds of Unity students are currently enrolled in its distance education program.
I think any institution that only chooses one way to teach is on borrowed time. We have an obligation not to change the curriculum, but change how, where, and when we offer it and make it more relevant in the 21st century.
It's something colleges around the country are now grappling with. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in Unity, Maine.
And thank you for bringing us that story. Thank you, Jeff. And on the NewsHour online, while so many Americans were consumed by losses tied to the coronavirus pandemic in 2020, it was also one of the deadliest years on record for mass shootings. And a number of gun deaths were linked to domestic violence. We explored the connection during a conversation with our William Brangham earlier today. You can watch that and more on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, Johnson & Johnson, financial services firm Raymond James, BNSF Railway, Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. The Target Foundation, committed to advancing racial equity and creating the change required to shift systems and accelerate equitable economic opportunity. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.